Chair, members can request that. Of course, at the moment, they're private because they're talking about private business. And I don't know about the position of the current companies and future companies, maybe very, very nervous about that.
Feedback on whether they think it's reasonable. Without going into great detail, as I understand it, because the firms have been named publicly, there's more than single views and not as anyone else in tow, but they're now sort of firmly signed up as partners since the meeting at the college on the docks and so on, probably since before that. And it's gradually narrowed down to these particular businesses that we're dealing with. So I'm going to get some feedback on this thing, barking and moon or whatever it is.
I can feel fairly free to tell you that had that request been made in recent discussions with one of our companies, they would have objected because they were coming to the board talking about regular cash flow issues they were having, trade union issues, staffing issues, all sorts of very detailed stuff that they felt they needed to get across. And of course they felt it so sensitive that they came and had that discussion, showed some slides, and then collected them up and walked away because they literally wanted to leave no trace whatsoever.
So Phil, are you saying that the question was reasonable premature?
Yes.
Well, thank you, Chair. If it's premature, it's not yet solved, set in tablets of stone or whatever. So if we were to follow the suggested course of action that I've asked for, like move it, then we can feed it into them and see what they send back.
The proposal here, Chair, is to select somebody who can attend those sessions as observer, who you trust to share with you personal information. As scrutiny members.
Thank you. Well, I'm developing something out of the report with respect to the report. We have the report, which has gone through the cabinet member, being blessed, and everybody else not called business district, and I'm suggesting a development from that.
Can I make a suggestion? I think I support it because it is broadly consistent with this idea of greater transparency. Could we ask Mr. McCall to go away and report back on the practicalities of the minutes of these various meetings being made available to members on request? So you don't have to give an answer now because everyone get, they're in the trenches. So just to have a look at how we could do that to make sure that, that the process is open.
The practicality.
Yeah.
Chair, it would be an ongoing discussion, so it would, for example, at the end of each shareholder board, saying to the companies, would you object to these minutes being shared with members of the council? And they would say yea or nay. And then there would be a balanced decision. As a member, you are entitled to detail, you are entitled to ask.
So we're entitled to ask for
you are always entitled to ask that information. There is then a process of saying, do you need to know that information? Basically, you need to know that.
Well, notwithstanding your comments as far as the court, it would be good to see a paper about which way that's likely to go. And that's why I've slightly upset. We're not saying we want one right now, but Phil does, and I can understand why. We're just asking you to, I think, just to look at the practicalities of that. And if you say, well, you've got no right to know about it, we've looked at this, then we can have an argument about it, but at least we can show that that will.
I think it's difficult even to know the parameters within which such questions can be asked.
Got some sympathy for the chair, but should this not come out of the workshop and have this issue be based at the workshop, whereby we can understand the whole? Because I don't think it should. If you're going to ask for the open transparency document, it shouldn't be just confined to this committee. May have an interest in, the environment committee may have an interest. It depends on the subject that's on the table. It's a council wide thing, so I think part of the workshop should be able to be delved out of that sort of information. About, I've been a board member of a company with X amount of millions of pounds. Past for 17 years, the board member of the Leadership Committee, and I'm one of the best partners in my core housing. So, you've got to talk about dealing with work with people. There you go, there's a carbon copy. screens. But the fact is, the reality is that looking at this should be looked at as a wider format. And the workshop is the right idea.
But I don't think the workshop can make this
issue.
Yeah. I'm not suggesting to make this issue, but it can actually make some recommendations.
At the moment that there's a very straightforward answer, which is that as set out in here, the minutes of those meetings could be private minutes. Members can always request information that you need to know in order to fulfil your duties as a council. That needs to be shown. Do need to know that information in order to fulfil your duties as a councillor, and that's the case by case basis that we're talking about, thus the factual point. So a standing, I want to see the notes on meetings that contain commercial information about companies that may or may not yet exist, is premature, because there would be a request at the appropriate time to say, can I see the details of X to do Y? And at the moment, there is neither an X or Y beyond this conference that comes into this.
Well, you forget this from
the therefore, the way that it's set up in here is precisely to cater for a balance between the need for the council to ensure that the executive is doing its job in holding companies to account to get a return from the council in its financial social investments, and for the company to be able to protect its commercial and confidential interests, and therefore feel able to come forward and be fully frank and open in those meetings with the council, in the knowledge that it acts as a commercial entity, and not hold back from sharing those meetings. So what the suggestion here is now pretty much the accepted model, is to have that balance obtained through having a shareholder board on which there are observer representative from Scooter to be able to have that extra independent eye on the goings on.
Phil? I'd like to reply, I'm working on this. We haven't got a roving brief as members, and we don't know about company or X or company Y, because we won't have information on company X or company Y and what they're doing unless we can ask specific questions, so we're somewhat locked out or sidelined. The land, if I go back to Cabinet June 2017, I think there were 49 sites under consideration, of which I think 12, 13 were blessed as like the first tranche of sites that might be looked at. And yet there was some flexibility if something couldn't happen in batch one, so it might happen in batch two. So, it's not so, I don't know, I may have it wrong, it's not so we're dealing with lots of other builders suddenly being interested in these sites, because these sites are in the property company.
Chair, sorry, if I can interrupt,
yes.
There's two layers of things going on.
Okay.
So, one we're talking about here is the confidential business plans of and regular financial returns and details of companies being held to account. And that's day-to-day stuff that's not for decision by the council, that's just part of discussion and checking. Then there's another layer that is decisions to be made by the executive member or shareholder representative, which would be published, and the reports that goes with them would be published, and you would see those, because any member decision is subject to publication. And then another layer above that, which is the example you've just given of the council deciding whether or not to put in sites into a particular development brief as part of the LIP. Now that's a key decision which will be published and will be subject to call-in and all of the things that go with that. So there are differing layers here. So I'm currently talking right at the bottom layer, which is about just holding essential or early solutions to account on, you know, we lend you this money last month, well, you know, can we see your cash flow this week? How are you doing this week? What's going on here? Differing from the next level, which is essential key decision, which will be investment of monies, of capital, or land, which is what you've just been talking about. That will be on the forward plan. It will be subject to the forward plan. That will be subject, hopefully, to something akin to a public decision in a meeting, and will be subject to call in by members.
Sorry, I don't want to be a grumpy old man, Mr. McCall. Those of us who look at the forward plan every now and again, thanks to the odd emails we get, and sometimes things highlighted in you as new, the forward plan often says the cabinet member will receive a report on where it is sometime between January 2018 and December 2018. Exaggerating a bit, but we usually get a big window of which time, which point something might turn up. Well, the idea of the forward plan was that the wall would be pulled over Joe Public's eyes, if I remember right. So I think we're rather drifting away from where I started about 10 minutes ago, which we were seeking in this mechanism, and we're going to put that point to those companies that in the frame and to see what they say back to it.
Equally, but those companies are surely not yet in position.
Well, you can respond. I appreciate that, but we're trying to set ground rules for you, Chair.
Yeah. And equally, just going back to Phil's point, is these companies aren't set up to be commercials when somebody's made a profit.
Forgive me, Chair, but some of them are set up to be commercial entities to trade and make money based upon their competitive edge.
And my understanding is that the one company that we've set up and what we'd like to set up are those that are can deliver outcomes more effectively. So we don't set them up to make a profit, we set them up to deliver outcomes. So if we think, and we are told, and we have the experience, we've been given the advice that says the best way of achieving this outcome, achieving more for less, potentially, is by doing it.
Sorry, the council only has one wholly owned company that is established as a trading company to go out there and trade with its commercial advantage to make a profit.
I want to get.
Well, in that case, I think we need to see them.
Well, that's the one. The
sorry, Paul Doughty, next please.
The chair that was at my exact point, that's the exact reason why I can't, because of the vicious cuts by the Tory government. We have to bring in income, and so the whole purpose of bringing, you know, creating this company is to fill the gap that's been created by the Tory government. So we are there to make profit, we are there to bring money in via business rates, via residential household rates, and we're possible to make a profit. That's why we're a 50% shareholder, and we will draw back the 50% returns and dividends as a 50% shareholder. We are there to make profit, that's the whole purpose.
I think that's essential. That's what to stop creating a loss if it's essential.
I do rather think we're now going round and round in soon.
Well,
I'll
give the recommendation.
I would suggest that in addition to the recommendations, that our officers are asked to draw up and report back on the establishment of a mechanism under which the minutes of the shareholder board shall be available for inspection.
I'm happy to second that.
In line with companies.
It's a project. It's been moved and seconded. And those in favour, please show. Those against, please show.
To that cabinet member who has taken that decision. So we can either endorse that decision or say that it needs further.
Or we can improve it by the
Can I just gesture that we know the content of the report?
It's been proposed that we know the report.
So, well, can I just check when we voted on that? Are we voting on recommendations that were listed here?
Or is it such as the report?
Chair, the.
I'd like to know.
I move this is open just to note the
report. Mr. Chair,
you moved that the meeting. Follow the recommendation, which was to note the role of the code of practice and the principles within it in relation to the council's own code of corporate governance.
And I'll second that.
Let's put that to the vote. We're noting the recommendation on page 35. That's what the proposition is. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please.
So what
you've just decided that we will note the recommendation on page 35.
I think that's what Mr. McCall said. What did Mr. McCall say we were voting on?
Chair, the referral to you from the cabinet member was to request that this committee note the role of the code of practice and the principles within it in relation to the council's own code of corporate governance.
Which isn't. That's not what it says on the recommendation.
It's part B,
which
like
B. Chair, it's at 1B.
Yeah.
So A, B, and C were all recommendations to the cabinet member. The cabinet member took those and made them as a decision. So therefore, the cabinet member has made a referral to yourselves and requested that you, as a committee, note the role of the code of practice.
Which we just did.
And we both did answer. Can we move on?
Well, that's an impressive piece of governance that we just had right now, isn't it?
Well, I think it took us a very long time.
You read it before, Jenny, that
Okay, I think we've done it on to the general.
I think I've found that recommendation. Mr. McCall, thank you, obviously, well done.
No, I'm sorry, Chair. I do take offence at that, Chair. I've not been it on to go on. I've just read out. Directly, the decision of the cabinet member as a recommendation to this committee. Please explain what element of that did I make up?
Well, we were asked to agree the recommendations, and they then turned out it was item B. You read out something in item that isn't written down in item B at the moment.
What else did I read out?
Look, I'm sorry, but this whole meeting is getting out of order now. Jeff, what you said was, frankly, very much out of order, and I think really it would be decent if you withdraw it. I'd like to propose that we go on to the next item of business. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
We want to vote on that.
We understand your work as Chair.
Yes. My understanding is you are moving on, so but just to be clear, from my understanding, what was said. I always apologise if anyone is a that's how it means to me.
My objection to that, as your professional advisor, I take my professional independence extremely seriously. And for a member to say, well, I've just read out what is contained on both pages 35 and 37 in printed black and white, as a decision of the cabinet member, as a recommendation to this committee, and be accused of making that up, I find offensive. I would be grateful if the member would apologise and withdraw that comment.
Well, I think we'll end up seeing the video, won't we, about what was said and by when. As far as I'm concerned, if you are upset by that, then I do apologise. And I'm not, and I certainly wasn't, implying anything about your personal credibility or your independence. What I was alluding to was when I was trying to find out what we were voting on, you read something out that I couldn't see, whether it was the full set of recommendations, which we were told we voted on initially, all those recommendations. Then we were told we were noting the recommendation. I was trying to find out what on earth we were voting on. That's the point. And then you read out or said something that didn't actually appear in those recommendations. Now, it might have been the virgin wrapped around them, but it's certainly...
Jeff, this has gone on far too long. I think I've made an apology. I'd like it noted in a minute, but in my opinion, it was an excessively discursive apology. And I'd like us to move on to item 7.
Yes, before my hands.
Item 7 on the agenda. The court will require a report from Mike Lane. Mike, are you fit and ready for it?
Thank you, this report is the latest in a series of reports around the interview. This one provides an update in relation to an initial set of actions that I set out in my report on the 23rd of July. There were two items I was going to bring to manage attention. The officer task and finish group, which is mentioned in paragraph 3.4, that's networks, it will meet again this week Friday. What I'll be proposing to that meeting is that we use something called the Cllr National Performance Model for this management, which I think is the point of evaluation treasury model for Cllr, as a means of evaluating current arrangements and identifying further actions that we need to take. I'd also just like to mention briefly the member workshop, which was proposed and agreed at the last meeting. I'm suggesting that we have a subgroup of this committee, cross-party representation at that. So I think the chair is going to make some initial arrangements for that. And then we can open it up to, if other members are able to make the day, that we'll be select. Very, very welcome to open up to the entire committee. Hoping to do that next week. And members can be so probably sometime in the late afternoon. So we'll find a venue for the day that works for people and we will put that in place. Again, I was going to sort of perhaps use to help frame the discussion the panel forms number again so we can see what the national looks like. Best practice is stated to be and use that to kind of inform the discussion.
Are we all happy with that?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, Andrew, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to thank Mike really for taking on board our suggestion about the training session, you know, it's a workshop for all as well. Actually, we've extended that for open new screening committee members as well. So I think that's, yeah, I think that's really good. Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, I think we were discussing item 7 and I've left on to item 8 in my way of thinking. So I'm happy. I mean, when we get to item 8, I'll deal with it there.
Do we need to discuss item 7 any further?
No, sir.
In that case, can we move the recommendation to item 7?
Yeah.
That's recommendation 8, and that's back over to you, Mike.
Thank you, Jeff.
The first vote of action, so the press of the court on the previous action. That's what we said. And that's what we just agreed to.
Sorry, Dave, I didn't.
If we said that's what we just agreed to. Pages 89, 1, 2.
My report to the committee on the 23rd of July stated that work to plan with the strategic leadership to refresh the council's corporate risk register. And this report provides a brief progress update in relation to that work. There was an initial discussion held on the 14th of August. To provide a starting point for that, there was a sort of individual review on critical risks provided by the Director of Finance and Investment. Those were considered, which led to discussion of further risk potential corporate significance. There were individual team members. I captured the output from that, so we had a record of that conversation. I'd just like to mention something that isn't in the report, only because there was a further discussion that took place last week, which was obviously after the publication of tonight's agenda. So there was a further discussion by SLT last week, where we started to look at the output from the initial session and some kind of further refinement that had been done since then. So there was discussion around whether the original set of risks were they were truly corporate or they something. Whether there were aspects of broader risk, who the risk owners were, etc. The output from that is still, it's still being refined, so that is not a final piece of work. But that's obviously there will be more. combine the two, the discussion of improvements and public risks, or the improvements. I'll leave that to them. So I'll make sure that they're contacted and I'll see what works best.
I just think, through you, Chair, I'm glad to see the two visions.